Hello, today we shall study the carding action on the card and it happens between cylinder and the flats. The function of the card is to do fiber to fiber separation, which is also known as individualization. The blow room opens the raw material into tufts, but the card must open it to the stage of individual fibers. This is necessary for the elimination of impurities that remain in the material after the process of blow room. So blow room is able to remove some amount of impurities that are there in the bale, and later on whatever remains after the blow room has completed its operation has to be taken care of by the card. So at the card it is necessary that there is a fiber to fiber separation to see to it that there is almost 100% elimination of waste. So according to the Ooster guidelines, the cleaning efficiency can be classified as follows. So classification of degree of cleaning for blow room: if it is more than 40%, it is interpreted as very good. If it is between 30 to 40, it is good. 20 to 30%, it is average. 10 to 20, it is bad. And less than 10, it is very bad. So one can easily see over here that the guidelines set by Ooster is more than 40, it is supposed to be very good. So you can expect to a maximum level of say 40% cleaning in the blow room. So the remaining whatever impurities needs to be removed has to be done by the card, and therefore the degree of cleaning percentage norms, or rather the standard set by Ooster, is something like this. If it is more than 90%, then it is very good. 80 to 90%, it is good. 70 to 80, it is average. 60 to 70, it is bad. And less than 60, it is very bad. So in a mill between bale to the card mat, or one can say lap, trash removal efficiencies are around 40 to 70%, and at the card, trash removal efficiencies are around 80 to 90%. So let us see the main objective of the card. Carding should open or separate the flocks into individual fibers, and this must be done for further cleaning, which comes after blow room, and also it should remove or reduce the NEPs. NEPs are nothing but small entanglements of fibers about the size of a needle head that consist of only fibers or both fibers and some foreign particle like seed or leaf fragment. So at the center of the NEP, there is always some kind of foreign particle, and around it, the fibers get entangled and they form a small ball which is of a size of a needle head, and this is called as NEPs. So the card should always be in a position to individualize the fibers for 100% cleaning, which happens after blow room, and also be in a position to reduce the NEPs. So these are the actually quality parameters for the card. If we are to check the cleaning or the degree of cleaning by the card and also look at the NEPs, then we should be able to judge or analyze the efficiency of the card. So NEP removal efficiency is given by the formula. It can be calculated as NEP input minus NEP output divided by NEP input into 100. So if these are some figures that are there in the blow room, like NEPs count per gram is 210. If in the card lap it is 550, which that means the lap which is being fed to the card, then in the card sliver, that is output, it is 61. And if further on, if we say comber, it is 17. In that case, if you calculate the percentage by using this formula, that is a NEP input, that is to the card, suppose we are feeding this, so 550 minus 61 NEP output divided by NEP input would give me the NEP removal efficiency of the card, which is coming around 89%. So similarly, one can calculate for if the input to the comber is a card sliver and if the output has got 17 NEPs, then it would be 72. But when it comes to blow room and we see that in the bale there were 210 NEPs, but by the time the lap has come out from the blow room, it is having more NEPs, that is 550 NEPs. That means it has actually increased the number of NEPs, and therefore the efficiency or the NEP removal efficiency percentage is going down, which is shown as negative over here, 162. So as a rule, the increase in NEPs in the blow room must not increase by more than 100%. So if at all it is increasing, it should never be more than 100% of what was originally there in the bale. So tasks performed by the card during individualization of fiber to fiber separation. So as the card is going to do fiber to fiber separation, there are certain functions or tasks that are automatically performed side by side as a result of fiber to fiber separation. And first thing that happens is elimination of impurities. It also eliminates dust. As soon as we separate fiber to fiber, some amount of dust is also released. The NEPs are also disentangled. Some elimination of short fibers also takes place as a side effect. Blending definitely will be better. Once we open fiber to fiber, the fibers would mingle amongst each other and one would get a good fiber blending. And also, since we need the material as an output in the form of a sliver, so because we want to transport and feed it to the next process in a form of a coiled can, coiled sliver into a can, so whatever output is there, the card has to also produce the sliver and coil it into a can. So let us now look at the wire point disposition for carding. Suppose we say that we are continuously saying that we want to do fiber to fiber separation. So what is the disposition of the wire point that should be there for the performance of this particular action? The operation of carding is performed with the aid of oppositely disposed or arranged sets of teeth. So this is how the set of teeth is arranged. If there are two parts, suppose we can say that this is the cylinder surface and this is the flat surface. In that case, the teeth are facing opposite to each other in the opposite direction. If this is facing from right to left, that is coming down from left to right. And since it is oppositely placed or disposed, this is the disposition which will allow us to do carding or rather fiber to fiber separation. So let us see what are the conditions in order to enable carding to take place. V1, that is this speed that is there, V1, if it is given in this particular direction from right to left, in that case, and also if this is V2 is also from right to left, this is the first case that's taken. In that case, if both are moving in the same direction, in that case, one must be, that is V1 must be, must have a surface speed higher than that of V2. So only in that case, if there is a relative difference between the speeds, even if they are moving in the same direction, only then carding will take place. Or the second option would be to move V2 in a direction opposite to V1. That is, if we were to move from left to right, and this from right to left, in that case they are opposite, even this condition would give us a carding action. In this action, the fibers are drawn apart, separated, and are aligned. So now let us look at the passage of the card, and we are specifically looking at which parts in this particular lecture. Let us see that. This is the cylinder on the big circle that one sees here, and these are the flats. So we are specifically going to focus this lecture on cylinder and flats only. So as we have already seen, the wire position or the clothing on the cylinder and the flats is in the opposite direction, which is seen like this. This is the arrangement between the main cylinder and the flats. Carding takes place between cylinder and flats only, which we are going to focus. So this is just an animation showing the cylinder and the flats in the form of, you know, how they work. So let us take a look at them. One can see here there is a large active carding area that is there. One tries to provide a large carding surface area. This is the cylinder and this is the flats that is moving. So having seen the animation, let us go ahead and see what kind of card clothing, what does one mean by card clothing. So first of all, let us look at the various types of card clothing that one would find on a card. So it can be classified as one flexible clothing, semi-rigid clothing, and metallic clothing. So this is the first type, which is flexible clothing, which was used on old cards. Flexible clothing is nothing but round or oval wires that are set into elastic multi-ply cloth backing. So one can see there's a cloth backing, and round or oval wires are set into this. Each wire is bent into a U shape like this. and is formed with a knee that flexes under bending load. So one would form a knee like this, that means it is bent, and they are fitted or rather inserted into this backing. And but what happens is during carding, this is able to move slightly, or rather they can swing slightly towards the left and right when the fibers are being carded. So since there is a knee that flexes under bending load and returns to its original position when the load is removed. In short stipple spinning mills, this clothing is now found, if at all. So as I said, it is an old clothing, and on the conventional one may find it on some cards, but if at all, even if it is found, it is only found on the card flats, which again is very rare because flexible clothing is no more used, because there are better options like semi-rigid or metallic. Let us see what they are. So coming to the semi-rigid clothing, in this, wires with square or round cross-section and sharp points are set in backing, which is less elastic than that of the flexible clothing. So in this case, they don't tend to swing a lot from its position. This backing is a multi-ply structure with more plies than the backing of the flexible clothing, comprising layers of both cloth and plastics. The wires cannot bend and are set so deeply in the layers of the cloth and possibly foamed material that they are practically immovable. When subjected to bending loads, they are therefore much less capable of yielding. That means they do not move, as I said, than the flexible clothing types. They are also, these types are also found only on the flats. So now we come to the third type of clothing, that is the metallic. So metallic clothing, these are continuous self-supporting square wire structures in which teeth are cut at the smallest possible spacing by a process and then reassembling a punching operation. So there is punching happening. We will see in short the process, how this wire is made and how they are mounted. So till then, let us look at the teeth and how it is actually drawn like this. If the teeth are relatively large, for example, as in the licorin, which we shall not be discussing here in this lecture, but the teeth on the licorin are relatively large, the clothing is referred to as a sawtooth clothing. The term sawtooth clothing and metallic clothing refer to the same thing. Nowadays, the licorin, the main cylinder and the doffer, all of them use metallic clothing without exception. So now, having looked at this, let us look at the construction of the cylinder and the flats. So the cylinder is usually manufactured from cast iron, but is now sometimes made of steel and is clothed with metallic wires. Whatever metallic wire we have just seen, let us see how it is done. This is something like a drum, and it will have a hub and a rib to give it some support from the inside. And this is the shell, and this is a shaft which would be there on the machine and which would be driven from the motor. So metallic wires are mounted on the shell. So this is the kind of metallic wire that is there, which is wound on the this plain shell. So there is a video which shows this, so let us take a look at that. So as one can see, this is the plain cylinder on which this wire, there's a roll of wire somewhere on the right hand side, and it is unwound and it is being wound on this particular cylinder by using this arrangement. So this is how the entire cylinder is clothed with the wire that one can see. This is the profile of the wire. So Now with this, let us also see in case the wire needs to be joined at some place, so how the wire welding is done. So one can see at high temperatures the two ends are welded together. And then since one can see a rough surface somewhere wherever it has been joined, one needs to remove this. First it needs to be straightened, and then some amount of grinding will take place with the use of this, just so that the wherever joint is there, it will be smoothened out. With this, let us look at the manufacture of this metallic wire, how exactly it is made. Starting material is a round wire, something like this. So first it would be a round cross section wire that is there, then which is rolled in several stages to give the desired profile. So how it is done in stages, the profile stock is passed through a cutting machine. So what is done is first it is flattened out, and then it is passed through a cutting machine. Here a high precision cutting tool corresponding exactly to the shape of the gap between two teeth punches. So it's like a normal punch, it will have the shape, and it will cut the wire away piece by piece between the teeth which remain after the cutting operation. So it is of utmost importance that the dimensions are held within the finest tolerance limits. So we have seen how fine the wire points are, so it needs to be done with utmost care. Hardening immediately follows cutting, that is, a wire is passed through a flame and a quenching bath. Here also a high degree of uniformity is required, this time in the hardness that is achieved. In fine clothing, the tip of the tooth has a thickness of only 0.05 to 0.06 mm. So one can see the tip is very, very fine, and one needs to be very, very careful in cutting as well as the processes that follow, so that the hardness is maintained and also the thickness is maintained, which is very, very fine. In the form of mm, it is to the extent of 0.05 mm. So with this, we've seen how the wire is actually manufactured, and we've also seen how the wire is then mounted on the cylinder to give the clothing on the cylinder. And we have also seen how these wire points are disposed for cutting action to happen. They have to be oppositely facing each other. Both the wire points on cylinder and flat should be opposite when they are doing the function, or rather carding is taking place between them. So now with this background, let us go to the important wire parameters. The most important wire parameters we are going to see now is the carding angle, the tooth geometry, the point density, and the tooth hardness. We'll see one by one. So measuring the angle of the wire. So this is one of the parameters which needs to be decided, that which kind of an angle do we want on the cylinder. So how to measure this in the first place? The carding angle specifies the inclination of the leading face. So if this is the direction of motion of the wire, suppose cylinder is moving in this say clockwise direction, and this is the direction of motion of the wire, then in that case, this is known as the leading edge, which would be the first edge that would be facing the fibers, or rather immersing itself into the fibers. So, and this is the vertical that one draws on the wire, and this is the horizontal. So if this is the right angle, so whatever angle the leading edge makes with the vertical, that angle, which is shown here as alpha, is known as the carding angle. So one must remember this. It is not definitely not the angle that this leading edge makes with the horizontal, because that will exactly give you an opposite answer. So one must remember that it is the angle that specifies the inclination of the leading face to the vertical. It is measured like this, leading face to the vertical. So it is described as positive. So this is a positive angle which is being shown, which is inclined more towards the base, and this is known as positive angle. And if it is a negative angle, so again we can see over here, if this is the vertical that is drawn, and this is the leading edge, this would be the angle which we have to move from the vertical to the right hand side to measure it. So this is going to be termed as a negative angle. Also, there could be the third type where it is exactly at right angles, the angle. And so if that is the case, then the angle that you measure, the vertical and the leading edge would be the same. That means the teeth would look exactly like this over here, going like this and abruptly finishing on the vertical line itself. The angle is neutral, and therefore the angle between the leading edge and the vertical would be zero. So we can have three types of angles, that is positive, negative and neutral. The carding angle for the cylinder clothing would range from plus 12 to plus 27. That means it would always be positive, and it would be to the extent of plus 12 and 12 to plus 27 degrees. Why this is important? Because later on we shall see the angles that are there on the doffer, for the clothing of the doffer, are very different from the cylinder, and we shall also see how the angles affect the processing. So with this we come to the another main parameters of the teeth, that is the tooth geometry. Angle is the most important parameter of the tooth, which decides the aggressiveness of the clothing. That means how aggressive it is towards the fibers, and also the hold on the fibers. Both these are determined by this particular angle, which is the one of the most important parameters for tooth. Then there are other parameters which describe the teeth, that is the base width, etc. So we shall see them one by one. So if this is the teeth we are talking about, we are looking at the teeth in one direction, and if we look at from the other view, it will be seen like this. So base width, which is shown as A, which will be here, the base of the tooth, that width, which will be sitting on the plane, say cylinder. And then you have a tooth thickness A2 at the root. This is known as the root, that is A2. And one can also measure tooth thickness at the tip, which is shown as A3 over here. Then another parameter one can one may have to decide is the height, H1, that is the overall height, that is from the base to the tip. Then you have height of the base, that is H2, which is from base to the root. And then depth of the tooth, which is H3, which is from root to the tip. So all these in mm. And then one can also describe the teeth as a pitch, that is the T, which is the distance between two adjacent teeth on the wire, that is spacing between successive tooth tips measured with the wire stretched out. Then one can also describe it as an angle, which we have just seen how to measure this cutting angle. It is angle between a line at right angles to the base of the tooth, that means the vertical, and the leading edge of the tooth measured with the wire stretched out. So alpha we have just seen, that is shown here, the leading edge with the vertical, this is angle alpha. Then there is one more angle that can define the teeth, that is the beta, tooth apex angle, that is beta, which is shown here, and this is nothing but angle between the leading and the trailing edge of the tooth. That means if this is the leading edge, that means the wire is moving from left to right on the part on which it is mounted, then the angle between the leading edge and the trailing edge of this particular tooth, whatever angle we get, that is termed as beta. So with this we come to another parameter that defines teeth, that is the point density. The point or the tip density has a significant influence on the carding operation. What this basically means is, in one given area, how many points are there. If there are more number of points, then the influence on the carding operation would be different if there are as compared to if the points are less in that same area. So how this is measured, we shall see that shortly. But before that, let us see what is the influence or how it affects, or why we need to change the point density. So for example, if the material throughput, that means if the more material is going through the machine, this is about material throughput being constant. So if the material throughput is the same, and coarse fibers, if we are going to process, so the fibers would be automatically in the same material throughput, number of fibers would be less if we are going to process coarse fibers. So if the number of fibers are less, I will also require say fewer points. I may not require that much density of the wire points. But since the coarse fibers would require more space in the card clothing. And on the other hand, if the fibers are fine, and so for the same material throughput, the number of fibers in that weight, what that is being processed, would be more, and therefore the number of points required also would be more to process these fibers to get the same quality. And the reason is that therefore more fibers are present. So with this, let us study how to calculate the point density. So point density is specified in terms of points per square inch. As I've just mentioned, in a given particular area, how many points are actually can be accommodated over there, that gives you the point density. So it is points per square inch or maybe points per square centimeter, whichever way one can express. And it can be calculated as follows. Now, 1 square centimeter means 1 centimeter to 1 centimeter, which is nothing but 10 mm to 10 mm. So, points per square centimeter is equal to 10 mm into 10 mm divided by base width into pitch of the teeth that we have just seen. So, if this is the, this dot represents the tip of the teeth, and we can imagine that this is the wire, and suppose this is the cylinder on which they are wound. And with this representation, we can say that there are 5 windings that have taken place. So in that case, distance between two wire points or the tips, if you look at it from the top as a top view, then the distance would be known as the pitch of the wire, and whatever the base width is there, that would be, that can be measured horizontally like this. So the if this entire distance is say 10 mm, so divide this by base width, I would get the number of windings that can take place over here. In the same way, if I take this as say 10 mm and if I say the pitch is whatever say x, then in that case I can easily calculate 10 mm divided by the pitch, that how many rows of wire points can be accommodated in this particular length. So in this manner, I can calculate how many points would be there. So there are 5 rows and rather 5 columns and 1, 2, 3, again 5 rows. So 5 into 5, there will be 25 wire points in this, if this is the situation. So similarly, if this, instead of it is square centimeter, I want to know in 1 square inch. So let us see that 1 inch means 25.4 mm and that is equal to 645 inch. So if I already know how to calculate, so it would be points per square inch would be 645 divided by base width in mm into pitch in mm. Since this is in mm, the numerator also we have taken as mm by just simply converting inch into mm and then taking almost similar. Actually, we have just multiplied it and got 645 over here. So with this, from the two equations that are given, that is, we have just seen these two equations. So base width, we can just reshuffle them. Base width in mm into pitch into mm would be 10 into 10 divided by points per square centimeter, or it could be 645 upon points per square inch. So points per square inch is equal to 6.45 into points per square centimeter. So if we were to just look at this part of the formula, so I can get easily get a relation between points per square centimeter and points per square inch. So one can convert easily by this 6.45 factor from one system to the other. So narrower the base width. Now one can imagine if the wire base width is very, very small, we can accommodate more windings on the in the same distance. That's why greater is the number of turns that can be wound, and therefore higher is the point population in the area. In the same way, if tooth pitch it is say less, in that case again I can have more wire points along the vertical direction, and that therefore tooth pitch will also influence the point population. So clothing with lower height of teeth is less inclined to choke with dirt particles. If the height is very low of the teeth, so there is hardly any space for any impurities to get to let it choke. So that's why lower the height, less it has got a lesser inclination to choke with dirt particles. So now with the parameter of point density, we come to the point where tooth point, how it is defined or what it means by tooth point. Carding is performed at the tips of the teeth. We know that carding is performed by the tooth tip, and the formation of the point is therefore important. For optimum operation condition, the point should have a surface or land. So although we feel that it is ending in a perfect small point here at the top, it is not so. There is a small landing or a land which is shown here as B, some flat area, which if there is better. So at its upper end rather than a needle form. This land should be as small as possible, although it is shown in an exaggerated way over here. This will be very small in reality. To provide retaining power, the land should terminate in a sharp edge. So to just so that the clothing or the wire point holds on to the fiber, it should end up in a sharp edge at which is shown at A, which is very sharp. Unfortunately, during processing of material, the edge becomes steadily more rounded. So as processing happens, this particular edge would keep on becoming rounded. The tooth point must therefore be resharpened from time to time. So unless we sharpen it from time to time under maintenance, in that case, otherwise it will become blunt, and the quality of carding or fiber to fiber separation which we would have got in the beginning would not be the same later on, because the wire points would have become blunt. Formation of a rough edge or a burr. So whenever we do grinding, there is a tendency to form a rough edge at A, and this must be avoided during resharpening. The tooth must only be ground down to a given depth, otherwise land B becomes too large. You cannot keep on grinding, otherwise this land, if you keep on grinding, we can see that as you go downwards, as the tooth gets ground, this land becomes more and more larger as we keep on grinding. And then that would be not be very satisfactory for carding, and at a stage will come where it becomes impossible for carding, so the clothing will have to be replaced. So during grinding or maintenance procedures, one must be very careful that it is not, one thing is it's not ground too much, and it should be ground just to a given depth, and also whatever rough edges are being formed, they should be polished and removed. So with that, we come to the next parameter, that is a tooth hardness. In order to be able to process as much material as possible with one clothing, the tooth point must not wear away rapidly. So as we said, if the tooth needs grinding every now and then after some amount of production that is being produced, so in that case, the grinding will make it blunt every time, and again, the tooth height would become less as it is being ground. That is, it will wear away very, very rapidly. So if that is not wanted, then the tooth hardness should be high. That means it should be hard. Accordingly, a very hard point is needed, although it cannot be too hard because otherwise it will tend to break off. So one must see to it that it is not too hard that it breaks off. But at the same time, we know that we are winding that wire on the cylinder, which is circular. And to wind that, the wire also must be flexible. So to enable winding of the wire on the round body, the base must remain flexible. So at the same, the wire point at the same time should be hard at the tip and should be soft at the base, or rather flexible at the base. So each tooth therefore has to be hard at the tip and soft at the base. So this is the hardness values, or the way along the height how the wire behaves. So A is here gives the hardness. One can see that it is given in Rockwell, and second way of measuring it would be Vickers, and B here on the x-axis gives the tooth height from the tip to the base. So this is the tip to the base, whatever height is there. We can see that the hardness is very high at the tip, and as we go towards the base, the hardness goes on becoming lesser and lesser. And this could be measured in these two units, one is Rockwell and one is Vickers. We shall see it in the next slides.
The Rockwell Hardness Test, Scale C. In this video, we will show how the Rockwell Hardness Test works using a gear wheel. The basic idea of this test method is to measure the permanent depth of indentation of a hard indenter under a test force. In the process variant scale C, a rounded cone made of diamond is used as an indenter. In step 1, the diamond cone is pressed onto the test piece surface with a minor force of 10 kilopons. The depth of indentation under this preliminary load is the reference point. In step 2, the test force is increased by 140 kilopons, which is acting as the major force. This means that an overall force of 150 kilopons is now acting on the indenter, and this force is held for a certain time. In step 3, the major force is removed again. While the minor force is still acting, the permanent increase in depth of indentation E is measured. This is how the Rockwell hardness is calculated. Rockwell hardness HRC is equal to 0.2 minus permanent depth of indentation E in millimetres times 500. Let's take a look at how the test is carried out in practice. The tester selects the conical diamond indenter and installs it in the testing machine. Then he picks up the gear wheel and puts it on the support table. After rotating the microscope lens to its vertical position, he can adjust his test piece. As soon as a focused image can be seen on the screen, the surface of the test piece is in the correct height. The test can start. In modern testing machines, the Rockwell hardness test is fully automated. That's why the Rockwell hardness test is used so often in automated production lines. That's it! The Rockwell hardness of our gear wheel is 55 HRC. This result is displayed on the screen.
So with this, let us also look at the Vickers hardness testing. So this is another unit in which hardness can be or may be measured.
The Vickers hardness test. The hardness of a compressor wheel for a turbocharger is to be measured using the Vickers method. The main principle of this hardness testing method is to press a pyramid-shaped diamond indenter with an exactly defined force onto the test piece and then to evaluate the surface area of the indentation. First, the tester has to prepare his testing machine. He takes the Vickers indenter with the four-sided pyramid and inserts it into the mounting device of the testing machine. He then places the compressor wheel on the support table and rotates the microscope lens into its working position. With a hand wheel, he adjusts the height of the support table until the test piece surface is displayed in focus on the screen. Next, he moves the test piece around on the support table until the right spot for the hardness test is displayed. Now that everything has been prepared, let's begin with the test. After pushing the start button, the diamond pyramid pans down and carefully touches the test piece surface. The test force slowly increases to its specified value. After holding the test force constant for a certain time, the indenter lifts again, pans back, and the microscope lens resumes its former position. This is the magnified indentation on the display screen. With a control knob, the tester now places four measuring lines at the corners of the indentation. Doing that, he can easily measure the length of the two diagonals. Finally, he only has to push the input key. The Vickers hardness value will then be calculated automatically. It is equal to the test force F in the old unit kilopond divided by the area of the indentation A in square millimetres. The Vickers hardness of our compressor wheel is displayed on the bottom left-hand corner of the screen and amounts to 125.
With this, we have seen both the types of hardness tests or the units. With this, we'll see the wire mounting. The base is broader than the point in order to give the tooth adequate strength and also to hold the individual windings apart. So, wire can be mounted as a winding like this. These are the four ways it can be mounted. So in order to mount the wire, the normal profile is either pressed into a groove. So first a groove is made and then the wire is base is mount or rather pressed into it. This is one method which is usually adopted for liquorin. Whenever we want to clothe the liquorin, a groove is made and then in that groove, the wire would be pressed. Or it could be simply wound under high tension onto the plain cylinder surface of the main cylinder. So normally, in case of a main cylinder, one can just simply just keep winding them one after the other on the plain cylinder without a groove, which is shown at B over here. Or one can have something like C, which is a chained wire, which let us say latches onto one another each winding. And similar, which is seen in D over here. These are the two types. D also represents a locked wire. So C and D both can be applied to a very smooth surface on the liquor end. In this case, a milled groove is no longer necessary, since these are able to hold on to each other because of the latching design that is there. Therefore, one need not form the groove on the liquor end in case we want to wind these kind of wires on the liquor end. So with this, let us again take a look at how exactly this mounting is done. A similar video which we have just seen earlier. So this is the machine, this is the roll where the wire is actually mounted. The machine is user-friendly and tensioning device is there and so on. It is ideally suited for mounting all types of cylinder and offer wires. These are some specifications of the mounting machine that we shall see. So now we can look at the cylinder wire mounting. So whatever we saw earlier, a little bit more was shown in this video, where the wire is taken from a roll, which also we could see, and from there it is pulled and it will be mounted on the cylinder. As we can see, it's a bare cylinder without any grooves, and on this side by side the wire is laid and the entire clothing is done. So once this is ready, then it can go on the card for our carding action. One can see here even the doffer is bare, it needs to be clothed. So with this, let us see how flat is clothed. Flat also is it's a bar. It is approximately 32 to 35 mm in width and are T-shaped. Normally it is given a shape, cross-section is T-shaped, so that it will prevent longitudinal bending, because the length of the flat would be around 40 inches and sometimes more. So it is liable to bend in the center. So if we were to give a T-shaped cross-section to it, the longitudinal bending of the flats could be prevented. A clothing strip is clipped onto the flat. The strip width with teeth is about 22 mm. Although the strip width is 32, only 22 mm would be available for the teeth, because the remaining space is taken up by the clip. There needs to be a clip which will hold the clothing strip to the flat, and therefore the flats do not offer a absolutely continuous carding surface above the cylinder. There are gaps in between the clothing strips. As one can see, these are the clips that are required to hold the strip, clothing strip to the basic, the flat bar that is there. So one can see that it does not, there's a huge gap between the wire points here and the wire points on the next flat. So it does not offer a continuous clothing or the continuous carding surface above the cylinder. So let us look at how flats are or rather clothed or clipped, and how unclipping and clipping takes place. For this also there is a machine, just like how we had a machine for mounting the cylinder wire points. In the same way, flats are also clipped. So this is the machine offered by Lakshmi. It's a fully automatic clipping process. These are some specifications of the machine. So first, if there are old flats, they are also known as tops. declipping will take place. So one can see this flat. As I said, it is a T-shaped cross section. It is the flat is put onto the for unclipping. And one can see that clothing strip is being removed. The old one is being removed because it is worn out, and new one will be replaced. So now this is a declipped flat bar. Now this flat bar, again the operator is putting it onto the machine for putting up a new wire strip. So this is the flat. He's just mounted the new clothing, and now the clipping action will take place. Pressure is applied and the flat is clipped. So with this, let us take a look at what is there below the cylinder. Beneath the cylinder and fully enclosing it is a grid made of steel metal provided with transverse slots. It is designed to remove impurities and maintain constant airflow conditions. So if there are any impurities that would be removed in between the cylinder and the flats, they would fall off below through the metal sheet or with which are provided with transverse slots, and they also maintain the airflow conditions in the region. However, since the cleaning effect is extremely small, some manufacturers such as Reuters have replaced the grid with a closed sheet metal casing. So the transverse slots or the opening was there on the old cards. On the new modern cards, this has been completely replaced with a closed sheet. That means there is no space for any impurities to go through, because the reason being that hardly any cleaning effect is happening below the cylinder. This is helpful because otherwise there would be a lot of airflow disturbances. So with a closed metal sheet that is, or the casing that is put up there, this enables a multitude of small air vortexes that tend to arise in the slots to be prevented. So the air, due to its circulation there, would have created some amount of disturbance in the flow of the material. So that is avoided by putting up a closed sheet metal without any openings. So coming to the flat, the carding surface is created by a large number of individual clothing strips secured to the bars of the flat. So we have seen how the strips are applied onto the flat bars, and now each one of this flat bar would be continuously chained to each other and would form a continuous surface above the surface of the cylinder. So this is the flat strip, which is such 40 to 46 flats are commonly used to make up the carding surface in the operating position, with a total of around 100 to 120 flats. So the bars of the flats are joined together to form an endless circulating belt by fixing them to a chain, to chains or to dead belts. So one can see over here, there are in the operating region, that means just above the cylinder, which will help in carding, there are around maybe 40 to 46 flats that are going to move. And as also one can see, it's a T-shaped web which is made over here, so that it prevents longitudinal, that means in this direction the bending of it would be prevented. And as one can see, there are more number of flats above over here. The flats would be moving in a certain direction and moving like this. So there are more flats over here. Now this amounts to around a total of 100 or 120 is there, out of which only 40 are in the operating position. The other are in the upward direction, or going to move in this direction, get themselves cleaned and return back in the carding area. So, function of the flats. Together with the cylinder, the flats form the main carding zone. Here, the following effect should be achieved: opening of the tufts into individual fibers, elimination of remaining impurities, elimination of some of the short fibers which we have just seen, unentangling nebs, possibly the elimination, dust removal, high degree of longitudinal orientation of fibers. So majorly whatever work is being done on the tasks of the card are happening, they are majorly happening in the cylinder flat region. The other parts that we shall see later on are only helping the carding action to take place between the cylinder and the flats. So let us take a deeper look into the construction of the flat. The bars of the flat are made of cast iron, nowadays aluminium profiles, and are somewhat longer than the operating width of the card. Say 40 inches is the width of the card, then the flats would be slightly longer because they would be resting on something known as the flexible bend or the adjustable bend, which would help in maintaining a circular distance or a circular profile, just like the cylinder. So it needs to be a little bit flexible so that it is able to be set and maintain a circular profile. So it is known as a flexible bend. And to the right and to the left of this each bar, they would be slightly wider than the actual card width, so that they are able to ride on this flexible bend. So it must slide on these guide surfaces. So these are the flexible bends, are the guide surfaces on which the flat would move. So let us take a look at this video, and one can see how the flats are moving.
There are also wire covered surfaces called flats that come in close proximity to the main cylinder. This is the area where most of the carding action takes place.
So with this, each bar is approximately 32 to 35 mm in width. And it might change to smaller widths. The bars are given a ribbed form, that is a T-shape, in order to prevent longitudinal bending. The profile is like this, it is somewhat inverted T. And it's a Tutzler flat bar. It is optimized light aluminum profile, as we just said. Securely fixed flat clothing, wear resistant hard metal gliding pins are there, which is marked as 3 over here. Then there are plastic fixing clips marked as 4. And the cleaning felt keeps the sliding surface clean. So there is a small felt piece over here. As it is sliding, the surface would be cleaned automatically. So a clothing strip of the same width is stretched over each bar and secured by clamping. So this is the clothing strip which would be mounted on the flat bar. The process we have just seen of de-clipping and clipping. So with this, we come to one more technical aspect here, that is the inclined gap between each flat and the main cylinder clothing. Now, if we look at one single flat out of say whatever 40 to 46 that are operating in the cylinder flat region. So let us take a look at just one single flat. The sliding surface at the end on the flat bars are not evenly ground. So the end that is riding on the flexible bend, they are not evenly ground, but they are slightly inclined. And this is done so that it is slightly thicker in the direction where the fibers enter. So if the flat is slightly thicker in the region where the fibers are going to enter, in that case, the spacing between the setting between the flat and the cylinder in that region where the fibers, that means as if the fibers are entering from in the flat cylinder region from left to right, that means the spacing automatically gets adjusted as a wider spacing here, and on the other edge of the flat it becomes lower. So within each flat this setting is maintained. As the fibers are entering, it gets a wider spacing, so it can easily enter the cylinder flat region, and gradually it is pulled through a narrower spacing on the other side. So fibers enter the cylinder flat region and thinner on the other side. Therefore, as the flats move over the cylinder, they have a slight tilt that is viewed in the direction of the material flow. The leading edge of each bar is spaced further from the cylinder clothing than the trailing edge. So the leading edge of each bar is spaced further away from the cylinder clothing. So this is your leading edge than the trailing edge that is there, which is shown as 1 over here. So this spacing is lesser as compared to the spacing where the fibers are just entering. Because of the larger opening when the fibers enter the cylinder flat region, the fibers are not pushed along, So there would be, if the distance would be same, the spacing would be same, there would be have been a tendency that the fibers are just pushed along in front of the each flat, and they are not actually passing in between the clothing. So this kind of a setting or an arrangement helps in making them pass under that. They move towards the licorin and fill up to eliminate the dirt during this movement, at the end of which they clean. So we shall see this cleaning of the flats in detail in the coming slides. So the flats would, if the cylinder is moving in the clockwise, normally on most of the cards, it would be moving in the opposite direction. So before we go to the logic of that movement of the flat, let us look at what we meant by we are keeping the, on one side we are keeping the flat thicker slightly to the, as compared to the other. So how this is exactly done? It is the process is called as flat milling. So this is again a Lakshmi machine which is able to have this flat end milling. So this is the flat. It is the flat strip is not there, as one can observe. This is fixed on the machine now. This is the gauge that is used. One can see over here, this is slightly a thicker edge as compared to the other side. So it's maintained in this manner because as this part of the flat is riding on the flexible bend, it will automatically maintain that the distance that we were just talking about, more at the entry side and lesser on the exit side of each flat. So one side of the flat has been already milled on this machine. So one can see. So the operator would turn it on the other side using that gauge. The flat also will be turned by 180 degrees and the other side would be now milled. So with this, we shall come to the topic of cleaning of the flats. So every time the flats move or are going to do the carding action, some amount of fibers and impurities, etc., picked up by the flats, and the flats need cleaning so that the quality of the fiber-to-fiber separation is maintained in the cylinder flat region. So the flats eliminate the waste by filling the clothing. It will all the waste will be filled up in the flat clothing. The flat must be cleaned continuously. While the 40 to 60, 46 flats that are there are interacting with the cylinder one, the remaining flats that are there, they are on the return movement on the endless path that may be cleaned and returned for the next carding cycle. So total there would be 100 to 120 flats. So as simultaneously as this 40, 46 are working in this region, this flat, this entire chain is being rotated. And it will come in this region where cleaning will happen, and once the cleaning is done, it will be again returned to the after cleaning, it will be returned to this cylinder flat region. So they must therefore be moved past a cleaning device 4, which is this is the cleaning device which will remove all the impurities that are stuck up in the flat clothing. Hence the name revolving flat cards. So this cannot be stationary because we need continuous cleaning of the flats. Therefore, it is called as a revolving flat cards. So let us take a look at the movement to the flats. The bars are thickened at their left and right hand ends in order to take fixing screws. As we can see, the flat bars, they are fixed with the help of this links or the chain, and there are screws which will help it to remain in place. Fixing screws corresponding to the screw holes in the chain. The individual bars are therefore can therefore be secured to the respective links of the circulating chain. So these chains are used on which the flats would be screwed up on this particular chain entirely, and then it will be mounted on the above the cylinder. The flat bars mesh individually with the recesses in the sprocket bar, sprocket gear. There would be a gear which will help it to rotate. The ends of the flat that is in the operating position slides on the continuous bend, that is a flexible bend. It is sliding on this particular bend over here with a metal to metal friction. So now let us take a closer look at the flat cleaning. Now one can have two kinds of movements. Either the flat could move in this particular case that we are seeing, cylinder would be rotating in the clockwise direction because feed is on the left hand side, and cylinder would pick up the material from here and move in the clockwise direction. Whereas the flats have got an option to either move from left to right in this manner and come back, or from right to left and then go back like this. So let us see both of the situations in which the two movements are given. If they are given either ways, what are the plus points and what are the negatives? So the flats move at a very slow speed compared to the cylinder. We have seen that flats are moving very, very slowly, but they can move either forward, that means along with the cylinder, in the same direction as the cylinder in the operating region, or it can move in the opposite direction. So the flats may be moved either forward or backward, that is in the same or the opposite direction to the cylinder. If the flats move forward, that is with the cylinder assists in driving the flats, and the removal of the flat strippings is easier. So therefore, this forward movement has the design advantages. So when I'm talking about forward, the motion of the flat would be like this. It will go in like this, and it will be cleaned here and come back and enter at this liquor in side of the cart. But in the forward movement of the flats, the impurities that are taken up by the flats near the liquor in region. See, now we must understand that this flats are cleaned and they are entering at the liquor in region, and it will immediately pick up the impurities at the entry level here, and then the flats would move in the entire region on the cylinder before it again is sent for cleaning. So this is one of the disadvantages which we shall see how it is fixed in the next movement, that is the reverse movement. So in this case, what is happening is the impurities are taken up by the flats near the recurrent region are carried or transported throughout the whole machine. So once it picks up at this place, the clean flats will pick up impurities and it will be transported like this, and it will travel the entire machine. But if we were to have a reverse movement, that is on the other hand, in case of the reverse movement, that is in this direction, then the flats would come into the operation on the, so the clean flat, so it is moving like this, it will get cleaned here, and the flats would enter in the, actually entry will take place on the doffer side. So would come into operation on the doffer side instead of the liquor inside. In this case, the flats are clean here when they enter a doffer region. Gradually they collect the impurities as they move towards the liquor in. So these are clean flats that are entering. And part of the impurity receiving capacity of the flat is lost, but it is sufficient. Here on this side, there would be relatively lower amount of impurities that are there. So it will just pick up along the way. It will come in this liquorin region, and then immediately it will get cleaned. So there is no reason for picking up the material and making it travel the entire whole machine. Material carried by the cylinder to the flats, that means whatever cylinder brings from here, it takes up from the liquor in and it will try to push it into the flats for cleaning. As soon as the flats pick up the impurities, they are immediately being cleaned by the cleaning system that is situated here at the backside. This happens just before the flats leave the machine for cleaning. So immediately it picks up and it is immediately cleaned. So that is what we are trying to say. The moment it is picked up, faster it is cleaned, the better. So Ritter and Trutzler offer cards with reverse movement of the flats due to this technical advantage that is there in the system. So as against the design advantage that we saw in the earlier one, Ritter and Trutzler have opted for this because it gives a better quality of the slider. So with this, we come to the maintenance of the card. That means we are going to only see the cylinder and the flat region, since we have been discussing in this lecture only cylinder and the flat region. So one system introduced by Ritter is the integrated grinding system, which is a classic type, and with this is meant for grinding of the cylinder. IGS is an automatic grinding system for the cylinder. The grindstone, that stone is there, is moved over the cylinder clothing by the automatic control during the running of the machine. We shall see a video on this. Unlike manual grinding, normally in the conventional card, the grinding was done manually. The machine had to be stopped, production would be stopped, then grinding would take place for maintenance because we need to sharpen the wire points every now and then after a certain amount of production is taken out from the machine. So during the manual grinding, there were a lot of problems regarding precision as well as, you know, time lost because of this maintenance operation taking place. So unlike manual grinding, where the machine had to be stopped for maintenance. So the grinding procedure takes place around 400 times during the expected life of the clothing. And this is happening as the machine is running. So unlike every 80 to 40 or 80 to 100 tons of material that is run, in the older situation manual, it would be a labor intensive and it would be after say 80 to 100 tons of material is processed, then the machine would be stopped and manual grinding would take place. So, but in this case, there's an advantage that it is happening. There is no need of stopping the machine, no production lost. And in addition to that, there is no risk of damage to the clothing due to improper handling also. And because of all these reasons, the life is prolonged by over 30%. So no loss in production during maintenance are the added advantages of IGS classic systems. The time between grinding cycle, that means to and fro, when the grindstone moves from one side to the other and comes back, so that is termed as one cycle, is no longer in the beginning, is longer in the beginning than at the end. That means the cycle, since it's just newly ground, suppose teeth is there, then the frequency of grinding in the beginning would be lesser. So the duration between one grinding and the other would be larger. And then as the clothing gets worn out more and more, during the end, more and more frequently grinding would be necessary. And the grinding occurs when the grindstone moves from left to right. So left to right, the grindstone will move. That is the time the grinding will take place. And on the other side, the grindstone will move downwards and is returned again to the left side to again for the grinding to take place. So because of this operation that is happening, the machine is able to give sharp wire points at all times, and it would also result in consistent output quality. So let us look at this cylinder grinding, which is introduced by Ritter, and it is a IGS classic system. So one can now see all the parts in operation. Cylinder is moving like this. The flats are moving reverse in the reverse direction. This is the cleaning system. And now we are looking at the IGS maintenance, the grindstone. This is the grindstone which is there. So it is returning back to the left hand side for the grinding operation to take place. As soon as it comes from left, it will make contact with the clothing and grind it during the running itself. And one can see the quality, bad, acceptable and good. So lifetime in tons of material. In the manual grinding, one can see the quality as soon as grinding happens, it becomes good and the graph is like this. But in case of IGS, it is consistently, even if it is going down, it is not, it's not so much variable. Graph is much more stable. In the manual grinding, with the sharpening cycles that are happening, we can look at the teeth, it is getting blunter. But in IGS system, since very little material is being precisely taken off, the wear is also very comparatively lesser. and it can survive for more sharpening cycles. Although here earlier we need to replace the wire with the IGS system that is there, the sharpening cycles can go up to 400 cycles, and only then we need to replace. So there is a lot of saving in the wire being replaced. So with this, we look at one more system, that is the IGS top integrated grinding system. We just saw the cylinder being ground during the running of the machine. Now we look at the grinding brush that is installed for grinding operation of the flats. The grinding brush is permanently installed behind the flat cleaning device. We have just seen the flat cleaning device. Just near that, another brush is mounted, which is meant for grinding the flats. So under the grinding brush and the single flat that is in contact with the brush, the spring provides. One can see there's a spring here which provides the contact by pressing to this particular brush that would be grinding. So the flats are therefore raised one by one and are taken for grinding. So each flat would come into contact and then it will move out of the zone. So grinding may take place for around 100 cycles during the life of the clothing of the flat. This kind of grinding is more frequent but less aggressive when compared to the manual clothing maintenance. The IGS flat grinding system not only helps in keeping the wire point sharp at all times, but also increases the service life of the clothing, just like cylinder grinding. The output quality may be confirmed by the consistent cleaning and the low NEP content. So if we were to look at the graph of the quality, then one can see that without IGS system, in case of manual grinding of the cylinder and the flats, the graph, as soon as grinding is happening, the quality goes up. That means acceptable NEP level is there. And as the material is running over a period of time, the quality goes down again. After grinding, it goes up. So the graph moves in this manner. So the second graph is the blue one, which is IGS Classic. That means we are only using automatic cylinder sharpening, but flat grinding is manual still. So in that case, we can compare with the earlier graph. Again, we can see that the blue graph, since as soon as the flat grinding is happening, some quality improvement is seen, and then again it falls. And this frequency would go will match that of the flat grinding frequency. So it means that if both of them were to be ground continuously, then in that case one can expect a better quality throughout. So if we are applying IGS top as well as IGS classic, both for cylinder as well as flat grinding, in that case only flat setting would be in a manually done. So in that case one can see the NEP level is almost acceptable throughout, and also one can see the extended lifetime that of the wire. So with this, let us look at the top integrated grinding system for flat cards that we have just seen. There's a video which we can watch. So this is the grinding roller, which will help sharpen the flats. We could just see that the flat was pushed towards the brush, and this is helping it to sharpen with every cycle. The main feature is that it is happening during working or during the production. One can see the difference in the sharpening that is happening in case of common or manual, and in this case it maintains the sharpness of the wire point throughout the running. So the time they are showing that elapses between grinding, this is happening continuously, so more efficient. So one can expect a high production constant quality sliver with the IGS system if both are installed, both for cylinder as well as flats. So with this, let us look at the final part of cylinder and flats, that is the setting between these two parts. So what is the importance of setting? If the setting or the spacing between the operating elements is too narrow or they're too close, it leads to fiber damage and also more waste removal. At the same time, if it is too wide, the setting between the two, then it would have a tendency to produce more leps. So a proper gauge was used in the conventional card. Leaf gauge was used to set the flats to the cylinder. This is how the leaf gauge looks. It is of the varying thicknesses, so whatever thickness we want the setting to happen, that is used for setting of the flats and the cylinder. The setting between the flat and the cylinder is around 10 by 1000, that is 0.25 mm. So let us look at the flats, how they are set. There are various points here, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19. That means there are 5 points for the flats to be set. And at position 15, now assuming that the cylinder is moving in the clockwise direction, and this is the place the first entry of the first flat takes place. So the first flat, the distance would be set at say 14 by 1000 inch or maybe 0.35, it's the same thing, given in mm. Then as we come to the position 16, that is as it moves, the flat moves further on the operating surface of the cylinder, the setting goes is closer and it still further closes at position 17, 18, and on 19 it will be somewhere between 0.25 to 0.3. So what one observes is that it is the material enters the liquor inside. If this is the liquor inside, it enters the liquor inside of the cylinder at a wider spacing, generally wider spacing of the flat. Entire flat region, and as it goes further, it is gradually closing down, and distance gradually becomes narrower. So this helps in gentle treatment of fiber to fiber separation in this area. And in addition to that, we must remember the discussion that we have had earlier, that there would be between each flat also there would be a larger spacing at the rear, that is the entry point, and at the exit point it would be it becomes narrower. So between each flat, within each flat also there is a spacing distance which is also sometimes known as a heel and toe motion, or one can call it as an inclination that is there. At the entry the spacing is higher, and at the exit for each flat as well, and for the entire flat region also, here there will be more spacing as compared to the exit side. So this is done so that the carding action is gentle on the fibers. So with this, we can look at the Trutzler innovation, that is the gap optimizer that is there. And let us take a look at how this helps in exact or accurate setting of the card, or rather the cylinder and the flat settings. Again, we see the cylinder in the flat. You can see the T shape of the flat so that it prevents bending. So when a manually a technician sets it, he would set it at say 10 by 1000. This would be the way it will work. The gap is 10 by 1000. After say 20 minutes of production, again the setting needs to be adjusted. Now it will be say 6 by 1000, so gap is reduced because the wire point would have worn out. Now we look at the gap optimizer by Trutzler, which is an innovation over the manual. So there is no manual setting, so automatically the gap has become closer after some time. It has become even 3 by 1000. So there is one more step. So optimized card gap, it is like paper thin, almost 4 by 1000. And without TGO, the setting would be wider, and with TGO, it would be optimized. As and when the machine is running, it is automatically adjusted. So this is the advantage of having a gap optimizer, which is an offer, which is an offering by Trutzler. So with this, we come to the end of our lecture, because we have seen all the aspects and all the features, the construction, the wire points, the settings, the parameters of the wire points, etc. All the features that are there, or all that is there to know in the region of the cylinder and the flats. So with this, we end the session, and in the coming sessions, we would be looking at the feed area and the delivery area, which would be helping the machine to do the carding action. So the main carding action happens between cylinder and flats, and the other regions, Likeren region and the Doffer region, would be actually helping the carding action to take place. So thank you very much.